Prince Sihanouk, ex-king, head of state of a country threatened by jealous neighbors. The most remarkable man in Asian politics. Hail to our prince, runs the doting song. Master of politics, master of the roads, the rivers, the land of Cambodia. By his political skill, Prince Sihanouk has survived and flourished among his people in Southeast Asia, while other monarchs have collapsed and departed in a steaming aura of corruption and treachery. The evidence is that most Cambodians adore him. The prince is hero. At 15, he was a king. He abdicated to become a popular political leader. He has kept his country out of the Vietnam War. He makes movies. He has a jazz band. He has everything in the world that he wants, whenever he wants it, yet seems a happy man. His country lives on the Mekong River, flowing from China through Cambodia and on to the miseries of Vietnam to the South China Sea. The standard of life of his people is low, but higher than most of the neighboring countries. In spite of primitive methods of agriculture, Cambodia is an exporter of cotton, rice, and rubber. The pastoral, salubrious land has preserved its priestly culture. The Buddhist monks enjoy a favored life. Celibate and fated, they are indulged. One day in October, as the monsoon season finishes, they travel to the Feast of the Ancestors. The feast lasts 3 days. For those 3 days, reverence is shown the celebrities of the civilization. The people bring gifts of food to their priests. It's like a harvest festival, except that the priests will eat the harvest eventually, under the eyes of their benefactors. In this ceremony, the people are blessed to give, the priests even more blessed to receive. Mostly the food is rice with fish from the abundant river. The Cambodians do not go short of food. Little distorts their ceremonies. There are few foreigners in the country, hardly any Americans, and the old influence of France is scarcely seen. And short of war, there is small sign that the civilization will be disturbed. After the festival, the people of the Delta take to their boats to visit their neighbors. In a land so unspoiled, the festival seems almost the natural way of life. This year's ceremonies were unusually solemn, however, since the monks were mourning the death of the king of the monks, an old scholar who spoke 17 languages and believed the world was flat. Over all ceremonies, Prince Sihanouk presides. At the Feast of the Ancestors in the palace state rooms, his ministers and MPs offered reverence to the past. If reverence for the dead is a test of civilization, Cambodia is civilized indeed. Cambodia was, for over 80 years, a French protectorate like Vietnam and Laos. Sihanouk won independence skillfully by exploiting the struggle between the French and Ho Chi Minh after the Second World War. Enmeshed in Vietnam, the French pulled out of Cambodia amicably. So the prince is thus in the unique position of a national leader who achieved independence and the head of an ancient ruling dynasty in a land where kings and princes have always been semi-divine. Feast of the Ancestors, to the astonishment of his ministers and courtiers and myself, Prince Sihanouk left the ceremony and came over to explain to me its significance.
All the Cambodians, they are always very attached to the memory of their ancestors. They are very grateful. They are not ungrateful people. They are grateful to their ancestors, to their parents, etc.
Is the principle, Your Highness, that, that the dead return for this period, that their spirits return?
We want their protection in order to have peace, continuing peace in this country, to have happiness, etc. Make prayers, we give food to the monks, etc. Dedicating all this ceremony to the memory of the ancestors. Yes, it is a traditional ceremony. We have it since many centuries already, since we are a state, and we are an old state, more than 1,000 years old.
Angkor Wat, one of the world's most spectacular wonders, a place of incredible beauty. The temples were built in the 11th century, around the time of the Norman conquest of England. In the great days of Cambodia, its empire stretched from here across much of Thailand and Vietnam. 200 years after Angkor was built, it was sacked by the Thais, an old source of enmity between these close neighbors. The statues exhibit a human quality, the people being depicted with as much sympathy as the gods, with a spirit that did not arrive in Europe until centuries later. Angkor Wat is a place to which Prince Sihanouk takes all his guests. On this occasion, Princess Margaret and Lord Snowdon. The prince drives his own sports car. Prince Sihanouk's visitors are usually more political. Princess Margaret and Lord Snowdon were on a private trip. Nevertheless, the visit was held to be a success, taken by Cambodians as a sign of friendliness towards them by Britain.
52 towers. And each tower has four faces.
Among Prince Sihanouk's many talents since he's been head of state is his capacity to remain on reasonably amicable terms in a part of the world where few statesmen manage to be neutral and at peace. One year he may incline towards China, quarrel with America. Presently, he's become more friendly with America, has resumed diplomatic relations. It's been a difficult course for the prince. Geography disturbs Cambodia's charm. It's surrounded by countries at war, Vietnam, or undergoing insurrection, Laos, or perhaps building up for war, Thailand. Along most of its length in Cambodia, the Mekong River, though, is still peaceful. But one of Cambodia's grave problems is that if and when she is attacked, those attacks could come from one of several directions. Cambodia is outnumbered 4-1 by Vietnam, 2-1 by Thailand. All her neighbors envy her lands and the richness of the river. The prospect is one that it's almost impossible to guard against. But the Cambodians do try. They are frequently involved in actions along the river as the guerrilla and regular armies in Vietnam maneuver around the obscure frontiers.
The battling armies on the Vietnam side of the river appear to be indifferent to the frontier, and bombing and shelling across the border appears to go on almost daily. For the last 6 days, there's been a perfunctory kind of battle going on between the Viet Cong and the Americans just downriver. But the principal casualties appear to have been innocent Cambodians who have nothing at all to do with the Vietnam War.
A few yards from the Vietnam border, I was taken to see one of the villages the Cambodians claim had been raided. The Cambodian army had a small outpost there, more an observation post than a heavily defended position. One of the officers there explained what had happened.
They come here by plane and by navy.
Well, they landed on the river as well?
Yes, on the river, on the Mekong River.
And what happened?
Well, they come, they attack the post deliberately.
Were many people injured or killed?
There are five villagers injured and three soldiers. And now they are evacuated to the hospital.
Yes. How often does this kind of attack happen?
From time to time, perhaps once a week, perhaps once a month.
Was someone sleeping in here when the attack happened?
Yes, there is a soldier who live here.
Yeah.
It is a...
What's this?
A bedroom.
Oh, that's the Rock American.
Yes, Rock American.
But where were the villagers who got
villagers, hit? you go into inside, and there are many other houses who are destroyed.
A problem which the Cambodian army faces is that the Viet Cong occupy villages, are pursued by South Vietnamese and by Americans, and so incidents become frequent. Consequently, the Cambodian troops at these frontier camps are not quite sure what kind of force they are guarding themselves against. In the forts, which are like small villages, they face their potentially awesome fate with great calm. Families live along with the troops. The Cambodian army is equipped from many sources. This gun is Chinese. The Cambodians also face the threat of internal rebellion, roused perhaps by North Vietnam. It may have begun. The Viet Cong are entrenched inside Cambodia, and Sihanouk sees this as a real threat.
Under the pretext that there is a war necessity, so they come into Cambodia. Already they occupy some parts of our lands, and they do not want to withdraw. Our soldiers, our army, you know, try to push them out. But we are not strong enough to, you know, push them out. But so far as the Vietnamese are concerned, you know, they have a very big population, and there is a lack in Vietnam, a lack of lands. They have not enough lands for everybody, and we have more lands than we need. So, you know, the Vietnamese red or blues, always they have temptation, you know, to come into Cambodia and to occupy our lands. On the other hand, we cannot avoid in the future communist Vietnam from north to south. Certainly, we shall together, you know, come to that conclusion. So we have to be realistic with the Cambodians, because our aim is to survive.
Do you think that your people would fight for their independence?
For their independence and their way of life, their way of thinking, their own philosophy. Because we do not share the philosophy of the Marxist. And I am sure that our peoples would fight. But we need weapons, we need planes, we need bombs, we need equipment, logistics.
Is it possible to acquire them?
We are not rich enough to get them, you know. But we would, if we have to face an invasion, we would welcome any, you know, sending from the free world powers of armaments and means to resist, to organize a resistance, national resistance.
Students are instructed in how to defend their country. All young people in Cambodia join the Royal Cambodian Young Socialists. Some train as soldiers. Others, especially the women, learn civil defense and first aid. When the attack comes, the theory is, the whole nation will be prepared for the battle for survival and independence. The maneuvers have to be carefully organized, since there's nothing like enough equipment to go around. And occasionally, as here, when the start of the maneuvers was due to be marked by an exploding smoke bomb, alas, it failed to go off. This amateur but enthusiastic force may never have to fight. If it does, it won't have many weapons. How good its morale will then be is impossible to tell.
Are you afraid at all that you may one day be involved in defending your country, in fighting?
No, I don't have friends. I will try all my best to protect my country. Yeah.
Do you think there's a serious danger of attack from Vietnam or from Thailand?
Yes, it's serious, but we cannot solve the problem. If the enemy invade our country, we have to fight against them. That's the only the problem. So only the solution to solve the problem.
How would you feel if your country was to be invaded by the Vietnamese or by the Thais?
I think that if it happens so, well, our prince will help us as much as he can, and we too, the Cambodian people, make the greatest effort to defend our country.
What's your view of the capitalist and commerce systems, American and Chinese?
Each system has got good qualities and bad ones, and we try in the when it's possible to take what is good. So communism is a bit idealistic, but it doesn't respect the individual personality of the person. As in the capitalist, they respect the freedom of each one. And our system, the Buddhist socialism, it just gathering a bit of the two and make it suitable for our country.
If abroad, the prince successfully drives a subtle route between rival ideologies, at home his methods are equally successful, if less subtle. Frequently, he makes surprise visits to the countryside, distributing gifts of sarongs and money to peasants who seem suitably awed and grateful. His political system he calls Buddhist socialism, a rather mystical and opaque creed. Under it, the rich are expected to care for the welfare of the poor, while the poor, in turn, are expected to care about the rich. The people thus, theoretically, walk hand in hand, in the prince's phrase. It's not a system likely to produce drastic change, a socialism of the spirit rather than the flesh. Whatever the obscurities of Buddhist socialism, its popular rallies have a familiar carnival air. The student pop group warming up the crowd could belong in the Western world. The crowd had gathered nearly 2 hours before the prince arrived. At today's rally, he was presenting a new bulldozer to the people and then going to join them in digging a new road. Until he arrived, no one, either out of respect for the prince or a more personal concern about the great heat, had cared to lift a shovel. The prince and his government properly like to emphasize their efforts to modernize the country. Visitors are more inclined to admire the absence of progress. But the prince tries hard. The prince's oratorical style is a successful blending of earnest exhortation and comic anecdote. It never seems to fail, although he has a natural edge on most political speakers in being the prince as well as a party leader. As he sets off to work, the prince moves among his people with an almost total absence of guards, rare for a man so important to his country. The prospect of assassination doesn't seem to occur to anyone, evidence either of confidence or semi-divinity. For all the new bulldozer, the methods of work remained primitive. Aid for Cambodia in building up her country is hard to come by, and undiplomatic, if necessary, quarrels with America have limited Cambodian capacity to develop her industrial program as much as she would have wished. But for today's ceremony, the shovels were new.
Hello. Do you enjoy this work?
Yes, I used to.
You're used
that.
To it. Yes.
You know,
in this weather, it's very hot.
Oh yes, but I am a son of the sun.
Are you setting an example? Is that the object to the people to work?
Yes, to work. You know, here the life compared to the life in the other countries in Asia is enjoyable. We have joie de vivre.
Yes.
And my people in the past did not see well the interest of the national building up. And some foreigners said that we are a lazy people. So I try, you know, to set an example. Yes, I succeed.
People are changing, you think?
Yes, but we are not working like the communists. Mm. We are all voluntary, and we work when we want.
Monsignor, I've been watching your political style. You have a very popular style of speaking. Is it something you've learned from somebody, or is it something that is yours?
As you can see, you know, we are one family, and they are always close to me. Yes.
You make a lot of jokes.
Yes, because here we like jokes, you know. Otherwise, we are not Cambodian.
Is there any political leader you admired in the world? Who was there, or is there, that you admired?
I admired the goal.
The goal?
Yes, because the goal, you know, has liberated his country from the imperialism of Hitler. And after that, the goal maintain the independence of France. We have almost the same ideals. We have not the same size, but we have the same ideals so far as the maintaining of the independence of the nation is concerned. And we prefer to be independent, even poor, than to be rich, but losing somewhat our national independence.
Of Asian leaders, what about people like Sihanouk, for example, what is your view of him?
I like very much my friend Sihanouk. He is a great orator, and he fought really the Dutch for the national independence. But after that, it seems that he spoke more than he walked. Mm. And I try to walk first, and I speak after walking. And there is no political leader who I admire. I repeat to you that I am not pro-communist, but it seems that Ho Chi Minh was worthy of admiration, and Mao Zedong and Chu Ân Lai also, but they are communists and I am not. So my favorite is De Gaulle. Yes. He is not Asian, unfortunately. Yes.
How long can it be now before destruction and violent death move along the Mekong River and overwhelm this enchanted land? The people put their trust in their prince. There is little else they can do to guard against a future of warring ideologies and a hunger for land. The tragedy would be all the more poignant for the splendors of the Cambodian past and the gaieties of the present. But in this magic twilight of their civilization, Cambodians find pleasure and comfort in the skills which have helped them to survive among more powerful neighbors for 1,000 years.